wings fall apart, the center cannot hold. Mere anarchy is loose upon the world.
Was full of turmoil, festering in the days before the start of the Great War.
As the armies of Europe clashed, the United States expended great effort to remain neutral.
It started as a European war among European countries in 1914, and really at the first declaration of war, most Americans thought of it as a European conflict.
At the war's outset, America's army had just 140,000 soldiers. The states, however, each had their own military forces, the National Guard.
We are, in 1914, when the war breaks out, we are, at best, a minor military power.
The potential was present to raise a formidable army, but it would require an unprecedented commitment of American resources.
We're perceived as a rather a second-rate power, vast territory, of course, tremendous industrial wealth, tremendous agricultural wealth, but we're seen as rather a minor military force in the world.
During that time, Wisconsin became suspect in the eyes of a great many Americans as being pro-German because of the large German population here in Wisconsin, and also because of the vociferous opposition to the war by Wisconsin Senator Bob La Follette. And for this reason, across the nation, Wisconsin had developed the reputation of being the traitor state.
Being neutral meant the United States could possibly make gains by helping to negotiate peace, and in the short term, gain economically.
Being a neutral country at the time of the war made sense. You could sell to both sides. You could potentially capture some markets that the Europeans had had and that now they obviously couldn't serve because the countries were fighting the war.
In Wisconsin, industry benefited from newfound markets and, despite perceptions of a German tilt here, the public supported Woodrow Wilson's commitment to neutrality.
10 million soldiers. Wisconsinites, like most Americans, saw the war when it first started as a foreign problem, an old world thing that didn't really involve the United States. It was remote. In 1914, no one was attacking the United States or any of its shipping yet at that point. And again, they sort of saw it as something going on over there that the U.S. didn't really have to be concerned with.
I didn't raise my boy to be a soldier. I brought him up to be my pride and joy.
Local newspapers, even German language papers, supported neutrality. However, after the sinking of the Lusitania, the U.S. started taking steps to mobilize National Guard forces into federal service.
I didn't raise my voice to be a soldier.
The National Defense Act of 1916 established, as a matter of law, that the United States would call upon the National Guard before it would raise any volunteer units to go to war.
the greatest advocates for the Guard, the leaders within it, really saw themselves as an integral part of the national defense establishment, and that meant if the United States was going to go to war abroad, the National Guard would be doing that as well.
Within months, this new law would be put to the test when Pancho Villa and his raiders attacked the Texas towns of Glen Springs and Boquillas. President Wilson called on the National Guard, and Wisconsin responded. The Wisconsin Guard mustered at Camp Douglas, units that would later make up the lion's share of the 32nd Division.
So this was a watershed moment in the history of the Guard, coming on the heels of that National Defense Act. It was an opportunity to prove themselves as men and to prove that the citizen soldier tradition of the United States was still not only viable, but essential to our military policy.
By summer 1916, Wisconsin's Guard was on duty in Texas. They started coming home in December 1916, just as the U.S. began the seismic shift to war.
So before the war, all sides, of course, want to influence the United States. The U.S. is the most important neutral country during the war. So there are even arguments that historians have made that, you know, the U.S. was never actually an innocent bystander, even when the war started, because there were these diplomatic efforts to get them involved, or at least, you know, be sort of benevolent towards one side or the other.
But German actions in January 1917 moved America off-center and into the camp of the Triple Entente of Britain, France, and Russia. British intelligence intercepted a telegram from German Foreign Secretary Arthur Zimmermann to his emissary in Mexico, seeking Mexico's assistance in keeping the U.S. neutral.
Telegram received. Second from London, number 5747. We intend to begin on the 1st of February unrestricted submarine warfare. We shall endeavor, in spite of this, to keep the United States of America neutral. In the event of this not succeeding, we make Mexico a proposal of alliance on the following basis. Make war together, make peace together. Generous financial support and an understanding on our part that Mexico is to reconquer the lost territory in Texas, New Mexico, and Arizona. Signed, Zimmermann.
The British shared this message with the United States. Most were not swayed by the news.
The one person it does seem to have convinced is Woodrow Wilson himself. And that was pretty key, because although Congress declares war, Wilson's decision to call for that seems to have been the most important decision.
The key for Wilson was less the threat of Mexico engaging on the southern border and more about the resumption of unrestricted submarine warfare. It was a clear indication that Wilson's primary goal was no longer possible.
So it's not that Wilson necessarily took it seriously. He didn't really think that Mexico was going to invade the United States at all. However, he seems to have taken it as a sign that Germany would never accept a negotiated peace.
The consensus was this was a necessary fight, it was America's fight, and it could no longer stay out.
Not long after Germany resumed unrestricted submarine warfare, U.S. ships bound for Europe were engaged.
And the Germans reasoned, and they were quite precise as to the number of tons they had to take care of in 1917, but the Germans were quite precise that if they could sink a certain number of tons of Allied shipping per month in 1917, they could bring, in their estimation, bring Britain to its knees. They could knock the British out of the war.
And eventually by 1917, most Americans had reached a consensus that although America would have rather stood on the sidelines of this war, they could no longer do so because the war had come to them. And this was not a matter of an elective war, that this was a war in which the United States had an obligation to defend its ideals of a new international community.
Along with me, there's a party across the sea, and they need your company to
grace it all. We left Germany
1916 and we came back in February 1917.
Edward Denomi, a Native American and member of Wisconsin's National Guard, was called up to federal service in Texas following the Pancho Villa raids. His unit had just returned home when it became clear that the U.S. would enter the war. Wisconsin's mobilization began well before President Wilson asked Congress for a war declaration.
We were home about a month, and we were called out for World War I. So we had to go down to Camp Douglas again, 6 regiments of infantry from the National Guard, plus 2 regiments from Michigan. Put them all together down at Waco, Texas, and made 32nd Division.
Denomi was one of dozens of Native American members of the Guard, many from the Ho-Chunk Nation near Tomah, Wisconsin.
Also, different Wisconsin tribes had members of the Wisconsin National Guard as well. So the Ho-Chunk, the Oneida, the Menominee, all had people who would go to war with the National Guard.
Denomi was not a U.S. citizen. He was exempt from the draft. He was one of more than 12,000 Native Americans who served with distinction. At the start of the First World War, Wisconsin had only been a state for a little more than 65 years. Yet in that short time, its National Guard units had distinguished themselves in the Civil War at places like Missionary Ridge, Bull Run, Antietam, and Gettysburg. Many of those units, along with sister units from Indiana and Michigan, formed the famed Iron Brigade. And in 1898, Wisconsin troops were again called into federal service during the Spanish-American War.
The War Department has notified all National Guard headquarters that every recognized unit will be called into service if the country is again put on a war footing.
As it became clear the U.S. would enter the war, the Guardsmen returning from service in Texas prepared for a new mission. In early March 1917, Wisconsin's Adjutant General Orlando Holway told reporters he expected a rapid mobilization of the National Guard.
These are proto-professional Guardsmen. They're dual professionals. They have civilian vocations, and they are committed to this particular profession of arms as well.
The now expected war would be a total war, calling on every aspect of American society to pull its weight.
And once the decision was made to enter the war, Wisconsin saw this as an opportunity to redeem itself in national eyes. And so the mobilization for war, the registration for the draft in particular, was an episode, an opportunity to demonstrate the patriotism of Wisconsin in front of a national audience and indeed on the world stage.
On April 2nd, President Wilson asked Congress for a declaration of war. Congress made their declaration 4 days later. In addition to the National Guard mobilizations, volunteer units were raised in communities throughout Wisconsin, sometimes spontaneously.
At the outbreak of World War I, there was no National Guard unit in Texas.
Scott Carey had served in the Iowa National Guard. In 1917, he was living in Platteville, Wisconsin, but wanted to serve.
I called the governor and directed me to the Adjutant General. The Adjutant General informed me to get 150 men as rapidly as I could get them. We missed about 300, but 200 who passed the physical examination.
Carey was commissioned a first lieutenant and mobilized his company of Platteville men to Wisconsin's military reservation at Camp Douglas, Wisconsin. Around the state, a massive shift of manpower began, with farmers and laborers, businessmen and university professors answering the nation's call to service. The newly organized companies merged with the existing National Guard units at Camp Douglas in Juneau County, Wisconsin.
We mobilized at Camp Douglas August 4th, 1917. We remained there until September 30th, when we moved to Waco, Texas, Camp McGraha. There we went into training, the reorganization and organization of the 32nd Division. Up to that time, it had not been organized.
Carey was not alone in his efforts to augment the Guard strength. Throughout the state, community leaders seeking to serve gathered others willing to do their part. This same story played out in 72 Wisconsin communities. Many felt they had a choice: go to war with your friends or get drafted with people you don't know. The Guard received tremendous support from both the public and the state government.
The state itself, the governor had to initiate moves to fund the clothing and the supply of its own National Guard members so that they would be ready to go.
In all, Wisconsin sent more than 15,000 National Guardsmen to join the American Expeditionary Force. In Milwaukee, parishioners of the Evangelical Lutheran Church of the Ascension gave their pastor, Gustav Stearns, leave to join the war effort. He had just returned from Texas, where he had served as chaplain for the Wisconsin National Guard soldiers during the Mexican border crisis. Captain Paul Schmidt, commander of Company C's 2nd Wisconsin Infantry, mustered his men for a second time. They had just returned from Texas. Wisconsin's National Guard and new Guard units gathered together at local armories, horse parks, and fairgrounds for training, and then moved on to Camp Douglas.
The thing that stands out most in my mind about Camp Douglas was laying in our tents at night. They used to blow taps. What I remember most was laying in my tent and listening to the bugle calls of the 121st Field Artillery, which was about 3/4 mile across the field from us, hearing that bugler blow taps. Beautiful calls. Then the 107th Engineer bugler would blow. Then the 119th Field Artillery Engineer bugler would blow his taps. One tried out through the other. Then I'd start and come to the infantry, and our regimental bugler would blow, and the next regimental bugler would blow, and so forth. So it was the most beautiful thing I ever heard in my life.
On July 18, 1917, while the Wisconsin National Guard prepared at their home armories, the Army issued General Order 95, creating the 32nd Division with troops from Michigan and Wisconsin. Together, they were ordered to train at Camp MacArthur in Waco, Texas, named in honor of Wisconsin Civil War hero Arthur MacArthur, father of General Douglas MacArthur. The division was divided into two infantry brigades, consisting of two regiments each. The 63rd Brigade, with the 125th and 126th Regiments, was made from Michigan men, while the 64th Brigade, with the 127th and 128th Regiments, was made of those from Wisconsin. With the 57th Field Artillery Brigade and support troops, it was a substantial force. The soldiers converged on Texas in September.
Camp to meet a soldier friend of mine. He'd been in camp for several weeks and he was looking fine. His muscles had developed and his cheeks were rosy red. I asked him how he liked the life and this is what he said. Oh, how I hate to get up in the morning.
Every day of the week was the same, Sundays and all, from 5:30 a.m. to 5:30 p.m.
The training was tough and regimented, designed on long-held principles of warfare, and required strict compliance.
The general principles governing combat remained unchanged in their essence.
This war has developed special features which involve special phases of training. But the fundamental ideas enunciated in our drill regulations, small arms firing manual, field service regulations, and other service manuals remain the guide for both officers and soldiers, and constitute the standard by which their efficiency is to be measured.
Day in and day out, we were kept busy learning how to be soldiers. Up at 5:30, we had 15 minutes for exercise, 5 minutes to make our bed, which meant rolling up our one and only blanket. And then we washed up and were in line for morning mess by 0600. They got us into shape with the everlasting drills and the grueling marches. There was artillery, bayonet, and grenade practice. They must have been in a hurry to get us polished up, because what had previously taken 2 years of training was squeezed into 16 weeks for us.
And Pershing, above all, emphasized the importance of rifle marksmanship and aggression in indoctrination sorts of training regimens that American soldiers went through.
The rifle and the bayonet are the principal weapons of the infantry soldier. He will be trained to a high degree of skill as a marksman both on the target range and in field firing. An aggressive spirit must be developed until the soldier feels himself, as a bayonet fighter, invincible in battle.
The conviction there was that this was going to cure what it was that ailed the French and British armies, that through an aggressive offensive spirit and skill with the bayonet and the rifle, they would be able to break through the gridlock of trench warfare and get into the open country where those marksmanship skills would come in even more handy.
The training called for sound leadership from the smallest tactical element, the squad level, and extended it upward throughout the ranks.
To this end, commanders will be required to lead their respective units in person in the most energetic manner.
The training required that each exercise be followed by a critique on the ground on which the exercise took place, and following a set process of evaluation, complete with a review of umpires observing the fight.
The senior umpire will then conduct his critique, pointing out only important errors and the lessons to be learned therefrom.
Along with the tactical lessons, there were also lessons on first aid, prevention of trench foot and venereal diseases, and the disposal of the dead. The training was not without its casualties, nor was it without the realities of early 20th century medicine. Chaplain Stearns tells of the letter home he transcribed for a soldier from Beloit, Wisconsin.
"I was operated on 3 days ago for appendicitis. I am feeling quite comfortable, and the doctors and nurses are doing everything they can for me, so you must not worry about the medical attention I am receiving."
"I then conducted my devotions. I then said, 'Well, my boy, I am glad to hear you were a Christian boy. If you should happen to feel any worse, be sure and tell them to call me at once, whether it is during the day or night.' The boy passed away the next morning at 2:00.
In less than 5 months at Camp MacArthur, the division lost more than a dozen soldiers to illnesses and injuries. By Stern's account, the hospital had more than 1,000 patients nearly all the time. Much of his time outside of training was spent visiting those soldiers who would likely perish from their illness or injury.
"Soon came the time when we got an extra good examination by the medics. They began separating the toughest and most fit from the others. No one, of course, was ever informed as to the reason for certain actions, but after a little experience, one could make a pretty good guess."
The final decisions on deployability were being made. From November on, the division received regular visits from the War Department to evaluate their readiness. On Christmas 1917, the 32nd was nearly ready to head overseas. Anxious about what lay ahead, the division paused.
"I think there were about 5,000 or possibly more present. A regimental band of over 40 pieces furnished the music. The words of the two best-known Christmas hymns, Silent Night and Come Hither Ye Faithful, were flashed upon the screens by means of the stereopticon, and everyone sang.
By early January, the 22,000 soldiers of the 32nd Division, the National Guard of Michigan and Wisconsin, were ready to move. Their final stop before boarding ships for France, Camp Merritt, New Jersey. And on February 7, 1918, Major General William G. Hahn, a regular Army officer and West Point graduate, assumed command.
There was a sail on the Tuscania, the whole regiment. I checked out a lot of things on the Tuscania. About 4 o'clock, the major came to me and he said, you got to transfer to the Arjuna, which is at Pier 54 in New York. Reason, some engineers came in California and there's no place to put them. The weather was very cold. Only one battalion of your regiment's going on the Tuscania.
Midwinter 1917, and the 32nd Division, full strength, trained to General Pershing standards, began the daunting task of moving more than 22,000 men across an ocean, hunted by German submarines. Company C of the 127th Infantry boarded the George Washington along with soldiers from another division. The 32nd traveled light. They left their equipment behind.
Essentially, we reached an agreement with the British and the French early on that we would devote all the shipping space we had for personnel, and we would leave the artillery and tanks and aircraft that we had, which wasn't much early in the war, we'd leave that behind and our allies would equip us when we got there.
Reports of growing strength of the American Expeditionary Force in France prompted Germany to take the offensive.
In March of 1918, when the Germans, in one of those additional desperate rolls of the dice, the Germans took whatever resources they had left in March of 1918 and launched a major offensive against the British and the French in the, as it turned out, vain hope to knock the British and the French out of the war before the Americans could get there in numbers.
While the 32nd sailed, the threat of German submarines was never far away. Their fears were warranted. Just 3 weeks before, in the early morning hours of February 5th, the Tuscania was attacked by a German submarine, UB-77, off the coast of Ireland. It carried a crew of 384 and more than 2,000 American soldiers, many from the 32nd. Randall Hertford was among 21 soldiers from Baraboo on board.
Randall was well below on his bunk on deck E when a thunderous explosion racked the ship and threw him off the bunk. Quickly listing to starboard, the ship's lights now failed, and the men had to find their way up to the lifeboat deck in darkness using the ship's ladders. Despite the panic and excessive crowding, the men were all orderly and no fighting, though jammed together very tight, and I was in the jam.
Hertford found his assigned lifeboat full and departing. He swung from one deck to the next by a rope, briefly considering diving into the frigid waters to avoid going down with the rapidly sinking ship. But he found a space in a life raft, and he jumped in.
We heard the cries of struggling men in the water shouting for help, but having no oars, we were powerless to assist in saving any of those unfortunate boys. In some cases, it seemed as though they must have been almost within reach of our raft. We could not see them. As before stated, we were in total darkness. This part was certainly heartrending, and words cannot express the feeling. There was not a word spoken among us. And finally, the cries and shouting ceased.
Hertford's raft of survivors was picked up by a passing trawler.
The papers, of course, carried the news that there were certain 32nd Division troops aboard, and relatives of all the men of the division who might have been on the seas at that time had several anxious days until the identity of those on board was established.
The division headquarters landed in Liverpool in mid-February, crossing the channel to Le Havre. Others made landfall at Brest on the western shores of France.
We arrived at 11:30 a.m., and the men were immediately put to work constructing warehouses. There were to be 52 of these buildings, each 500 feet in length, to be used for storing supplies. The American troops also laid 16 miles of railroad track.
The division was spread across France, from the Bordeaux to the Haute-Marne. The plan, as laid out before the 32nd left Texas, was to use the division as a replacement unit, separating its parts and filling in existing units. The 128th Infantry went immediately to the front to replace troops in the 1st Infantry Division.
The 128th Infantry reached the 10th area in March and bore the brunt of the replacement blow, just as it was destined to bear the brunt of other blows later on.
The replacement work lasted about 4 weeks. During that time, the privates and captains of the 128th were transferred to the 1st Division, who had completed their training and were already in the trenches. General Hahn, a longtime colleague of General Pershing's, lobbied to keep his division together.
The alleged reason is for the saving of transportation, but by careful reading of the telegram, it will be seen that practically no transportation will be saved. I wish it distinctly understood that I am ready to do anything or to have the troops of my division placed anywhere, provided they are so utilized as to produce the best general effect.
Hahn argued that his division had trained together and would fight best together, and that any perceived logistical savings would be an illusion. Hahn made his point, and the leadership agreed. The unit came together in the Alsace, where combat was less intense, and the division could gain critical combat experience and additional training.
In point of fact, they really did need to learn the hard, tedious lessons of how to live and fight in a static defensive form of warfare in order to survive that environment and get to the point where they could use maneuver-based warfare.
A part of the training consisted in the construction of trenches. In the rocky soil of this part of France, trench digging was more of a mining than an agricultural operation.
By the 18th of May, the 1st Combat Troops of the 32nd Division were assigned combat duty in Haute-Alsace.
Jolly, get your gun. Take it on the run. Here
Captain Schmidt recalls the naivete of his troops, climbing cherry trees to pick fruit and being shot at by snipers. And on the morning after they arrived, they were welcomed with a message from the Germans.
An interesting sidelight showing the thoroughness of the German spy system was the surprise of our troops the following morning when they looked over the parapet of the trenches to observe a long banner stretched over the German trenches reading, "Welcome, 32nd Division."
By June, all but 2,000 of the division were together on the Alsace front, in direct contact with the German army. They were being trained by the French for a planned move to the combat-intense Western Front.
They say that so large a body of troops such as the Germans are using in this offensive, perhaps approximately 1 million men, cannot be stopped until after a considerable advance has been made, but that it will recoil as soon as its flanks are attacked, and possibly with disastrous results.
General Hahn had a clear picture of the fight. The German army offensive of March 1918 sought to split the French and British forces, isolate the French from the fight, and concentrate on forcing the British out of the war before the American forces could become fully engaged.
The war was on to beat the band, you know.
Germans were driving the French and British back. They were pounding us on the back, and the training was rough, it was hard.
The Americans are green, not well trained perhaps, and their commanders had yet to really see the kind of total warfare that was being fought in Europe with tremendous modern firepower. The result is the Americans make many of the same mistakes the British and the French had made in 1914, and the cost is horrendous.
General Hahn worked his division hard, pushing it in its final month in the Alsace before being put into the crucible.
My training schedule for officers calls for 12 hours work a day, and the man who doesn't come up to the mark loses his job without further ceremony. In the last 60 days, 82 have been eliminated for lack of energy. I don't believe in sending men into battle under men who themselves do not have the energy to fill their own jobs, so I just relieve them. I expect they will go to the service of the rear some other place. I don't care much where.
We began a season of very intensive training in target practice and formations in French tactics, under French instructors. One French instructor was assigned to each battalion.
While this time was considered training, it was also time in direct contact with the enemy.
Where we are now located, it is forbidden to have any large outdoor gatherings, as we are within easy range of the German guns, and German aeroplanes may come sailing over us at any time.
At the end of May, four battalions of the 32nd were on the front line, and General Hahn received word from the French that their work was satisfactory.
So we finally got into the Alsace Lorraine sector, which was a quiet sector. The fire would come to you like that. The Germans didn't want to shut up, and the French didn't want to shut up. So they're in there for training, both of them. We had trenches on both sides.
And it was during this training time the division experienced its first ground combat casualties.
I had a man killed yesterday and another one today by machine gun fire and the other one by artillery. Another one was slightly wounded today. These are my first casualties in battle, and I take it we will soon get some more. As I am dictating, some shells are exploding. Some of ours are exploding on the other side.
I was in the frontline trenches the day he was killed. His name was Private Kenneth Counter. He was a member of my regiment. He was not, however, a Milwaukee boy.
On the morning of May 27th, the Germans amassed a large force and began a surprise offensive. Hahn credits German discipline for its rapid success, having marched their divisions by night and remaining out of sight of airplane reconnaissance.
And in that way concentrated some 20 or 30 divisions back of the line preparatory for the present offensive, which, according to the last reports, is still progressing on a line about 5 kilometers south of Vesle between Soissons and Reims.
In the coming weeks, the 32nd would meet the German army on this ground. Until then, their time in the Alsace grew more intense.
When the Germans come in, they mistook a machine gun post that was out there for the dugout. And they opened up with liquid fire. Well, that two or nine guys off. And so they just returned the fire like that. And there were some of those guys. They killed some of them, wounded a couple, they took some prisoners.
More and more of Chaplain Stern's time was spent performing funeral rites for both American and German soldiers.
It was in perfect harmony with military regulations to bury any soldier who was killed in action, whether he was one of our comrades or not. It was likely that the parents of the dead soldier would learn where he was killed and would come to this place in search of his grave.
Colonel announced we were going to front. And I said to the colonel, I said, I don't think it'd be any worse than damn training business.
In late July, the division was pulled off the line in the Alsace and moved to Chatel Terre and their first offensive operations.
Our route took us through the devastated territory laid bare by the terrible conflicts which were waged between the French, American, and German armies. Fields jagged with shell holes, towns destroyed, and graves marked with crosses gave mute and tragic testimony of the fearful carnage of life left in the wake of these sanguinary struggles.
The German army had been driven out by the 3rd Division and the French forces.
It was still light enough to notice evidence of the beauty of this locality. Before the ravages of war blasted the landscape, we continued to march through the city, our hungry troops who had nothing to eat since the day before, pulling whatever vegetables could be found growing in the gardens and eating them raw.
Captain Schmidt and the 127th Infantry crossed the Marne and waited.
We were now in the fighting area, and the 32nd Division was prepared for real action.
We are no longer in the place where we were when I wrote my last weekly letter. We had been occupying the frontline trenches of a certain sector for about 2 months, but we have now been moved to a sector which is much more active and where the warfare is entirely different.
In the Alsace, the war was fought from the trenches.
Where we are now, it is battles in the open, and trenches are not dug or used, because we are taking part in a big drive.
This would be warfare General Hahn and the Allied forces had sought, a maneuver conflict fought on open ground. Captain Schmidt and his men were ordered forward, and to hold that ground until troops arrived on his right flank.
I sent 10 men forward with ammunition supplies. These men advanced cautiously, but were met with a deadly fire from the enemy guns. Floyd Riffle, of Chilton, was instantly killed. Riffle was the first man of Company C killed in battle on foreign soil.
Schmidt then moved his company forward en masse.
We advanced about 1 mile, marching through a deep ravine, the men going forward single file by squads, with 25 yards between squads, until both companies reached Roncher.
He searched for the command post, but he could not immediately find it.
I found an aid station in charge of Lieutenant Otto Hintz, a dentist from Oshkosh. This was a veritable charnel house. I never saw so much blood at one time, and I earnestly trust that I shall never have to look upon so much human gore. Lieutenant Hintz was almost exhausted, and a short time later collapsed. He had performed the almost incredible task of dressing the wounds and taking care of 172 men that day.
The American conception of open warfare was not necessarily as misplaced as it might have seemed. Unfortunately for the Americans, because of their lack of training and because of their preference for aggressive tactics, didn't necessarily practice what we would today consider to be the fundamentals of fire and movement or fire maneuver when crossing over these open spaces.
General Hahn assumed command of the sector from the 3rd Division.
The woods were covered with machine guns, but our troops took it by storm and bayoneted the Germans in the woods when they made a counterattack on one of their flanks. The bayonet fight took place at 11 at night and lasted half an hour. So far as I can ascertain, not a shot was fired, and the Germans were completely routed. More than 30 of them were buried on this spot. Here, no prisoners were taken.
But when the 32nd Division, for instance, makes its initial debut in combat, it's still very green, and its mistakes are those of ambitious, aggressive, offensive-minded troops who want to take the fight to the enemy, but have not yet learned the finer art of joint doctrine.
Hahn's diary indicates he maintained a pragmatic view of the fight.
More than 500 Germans were buried on this hill and in Grimpitz Woods, so that the German dead exceeded by 100% the American dead, which is evidence that our men attacked in a scientific manner.
The division moved from La Charnelle to Roncher, and from there advanced to Siege, From Han's new vantage point, he saw the need to claim the high ground, a hill just north of Bellevue, identified on the map by its elevation, Hill 230.
The position marked by Bellevue Farm and 230-meter hill, which was the center and the key to the whole line, was carried after fierce fighting.
The 125th and 126th Infantry, composed of Michigan troops, were on our left during this engagement. Suddenly, from in front of us, over in the direction where we knew the Germans were located, we saw skyrocket signals and flares go up, and then the boom, boom, boom of artillery, and then the zip, zip, zip multiplied a thousandfold of the machine guns, and then some shells came crashing over toward us, and someone yelled, "Gas!"
Pushed from the high ground, the Germans gave way rapidly. The division gained about 6 kilometers and found themselves in front of their flanking units, the French 4th and the American 42nd Division, by more than a mile. General Han continued his push.
The order to carry on as rapidly as possible was received, and the next day the division pushed into the hills south of the Vesle River, where it came under heavy artillery fire from the north of that river.
The objective of this offensive was the city of Fismes, a key railroad center on the banks of the Vesle.
The Germans had spared no effort in making this city and surrounding country as impregnable as science could make it. Huge stores of ammunition and engines of destruction were located here, and preparations made to withstand the most formidable attack.
The hills on the opposite banks were within 800 meters of the river and had a command over the river of 240 feet in elevation.
While Captain Schmidt was emplacing his soldiers outside of Fismes, he was spied in the open by a German machine gunner.
My first intimation that I was being made a target was the song of the bullets. My one salvation was to make the gunner think he got me. Acting on this impulse, I suddenly threw up both hands as a man who had really been hit would do and fell heavily to the ground, feigning dead.
Schmidt laid on the ground for more than 2 hours until the dark of night masked his movement.
I rose and walked back to the trench, feeling that I had had enough and convinced that I had been as near death as any man could be and still be alive.
This was while the 2nd and 3rd Battalions fought within the city, pushing the Germans once again backwards.
We could see the Germans retreating across the river into Fismes and up the hills on the opposite side, keeping up a heavy fire with both artillery and machine guns in their retreat.
After the enemy had concentrated his artillery on Fismes for a short time in the afternoon, he attacked the town in force via Chassel's farm at 4:30 p.m. He succeeded in pushing through the line of outposts, forcing back the forces detailed to defend the town and capturing it.
The victory in Fismes marked the end of the division's first offensive. Han estimated his losses in killed and wounded above 4,000. With replacements and recuperation, he estimated his division could be ready to fight again in 2 weeks' time. And with this victory, he saw the beginning of the end of the German army.
It is doubtful to me whether the Germans have left the sufficient strength to make another big offensive, and I'm not sure but that a quick offensive by the Allies on the north might not place him in a bad position for the winter.
Collectively, we could call this the Second Battle of the Marne, and there's subordinate engagements with it, but it really is a turning point in the war because the culmination of the last German attack in the Marne sector in mid-July 1918 is the precise moment when the Germans lose the initiative in this war and they never regain it. The 32nd Division is one of those follow-on forces in that northward moving pincer that culminates near the Vesle River, and the 32nd experiences its first trial in combat during that offensive and completes the defeat of German forces that had been defending in that sector. And so the 32nd is a vital cog in a larger Allied effort, French and American effort, to turn the tide.
Meanwhile, the division would shelter and rest, awaiting replacements, and Chaplain Stearns would write another letter to his home church.
I should like to write a much longer letter, but I have looked at my watch and I must get busy with other duties. I must bury the dead.
We have been out of the line now 11 days and have received practically no replacements, either in officers or men. I do not quite understand what it means.
After 8 days of fighting and the successful drive to the Vesla River, the 32nd Division lost more than 600 killed in action, more than 4,000 others wounded. Hahn expected replacements and to be part of a continuous drive of the German army north and east.
My division is not a good division to sit on a quiet front. I think it prefers active operations. It is full of ginger, and the Boche has found this out.
So in the 32nd's next major combat operations, it's the only American division assigned to the famous French 10th Army, it essentially finishes what it had started in its earlier drive toward the Vesla.
The new orders came, and it put the 32nd at the point of the spear. It was a strategic left hook that, if successful, would make it impossible for German forces to hold a western line along the Vesla River.
The Germans don't actually retire from that village or the banks of the Vesla until that second offensive, in which the 32nd Division is one of the crucial components of an unhinging of that defensive position.
The new objective, Juvigny.
Germans in vast numbers occupied the city of Juvigny and also the surrounding territory. And the events which follow in chronological sequence will prove what a stupendous task the troops of the 32nd Division, and especially those of Company C, had to play.
We are right in the thick of it again. One of the new features in connection with the drive we are in now is the large number of tanks we have at our disposal.
The attack was set for the early morning of August 29th.
The ground in this terrain was undulating in open fields, stretching far to the east, giving us an unobstructed view of the country for many miles.
Artillery pounded German positions for an hour before the assault began. The advance stalled after just a few hundred meters in the face of heavy machine gun and artillery fire.
Early on the morning of August 30th, a squadron of enemy aeroplanes flew over our lines and in rapid succession shot down three French observation balloons, which fell near our position.
During the day, the 32nd assault continued in pushes that brought them within a mile of Juvigny. German artillery fire was intense, matched round for round with Allied artillery, all landing very close to the division's positions.
They dropped the shell that I thought was going to hit me on the head. Screamed so loud when it passed over me, it couldn't have been over 3-4 feet above my head. It landed behind me in Company G from Madison, Wisconsin. And it hit and killed 14 men and wounded 29. I'll never forget looking at a pile of men the next day, and I remember seeing an officer who was from Madison, and he was in that pile with his legs sticking out and his silver bars on his shoulder. I could see he was a lieutenant. What a mess that was.
The Army commander greatly admired the pluck of the American division and troops, but he feared serious consequences in case our division should make so great an advance in the front of that line that our casualties might be very heavy. The brigade commander believed that his casualties would be less in the advanced position than where he was, and in this I thoroughly agreed with him.
By the end of the day, the division was poised to take the city.
Our patrols had penetrated into the woods at the southern edge of the sector. There was no artillery barrage for this advance. The advance was launched first on the right flank and then successively on the left flank. This came under heavy fire, and we had many casualties.
The divisions to the left and to the right of the 32nd were unable to advance.
Our battalion took a position. at the foot of a bluff about 200 feet high, east of Juvigny. The Germans were holding positions with machine guns along a road and also in the woods about 300 yards east of our lines.
At 3 p.m. on September 1st, the division attacked.
The bullets came so thick and fast that they brought a strong current of air with them. This was the most violent machine gun fire ever directed at one given line.
Schmidt was struck by a ricochet. Thinking he'd been shot through the leg and considering the intensity of the fire, he and his men took shelter in a nearby trench. Meanwhile, the division moved through the city, taking nearly 200 prisoners and 40 German machine guns. Schmidt's wounds were minor, and he was able to continue leading his company.
So once the 32nd secures positions in Juvigny, at that point the Germans realize that their Vesle River line is no longer tenable, and they withdraw again back to a next line of defense.
The following day, the division continued its attack to the east, claiming the road to the west of Tourny-Sarnay. They claimed another 550 prisoners.
They were tickled but they had to give up. A lot of the prisoners, we took them like that, they were happy to stay in prisoners. They're going to be safe. They're full of good guys. Says, I'd rather be a live coward than a dead hero.
Chaplain Stearns was allowed to visit with the German POWs.
I asked the soldiers to hand me one of the pocket hymnals or prayer books, which is given to every German soldier. I removed my cap and all the Germans did the same. And then I conducted a short service.
The other reason that the operations that culminate in the Battle of Juvigny are significant is because they demonstrate the tremendous growth of the 32nd Division as an effective combat force within the AEF. Whereas previously their operations had been distinguished by a preference for frontal assaults and almost exclusive reliance on rifle fire, and these operations, they demonstrated skill in the employment of light machine guns, medium machine guns, mortars, calling for artillery, the hallmarks of combined arms doctrine.
In their first two battles in this offensive, the division pushed the German line nearly 25 kilometers, a point of pride for General Hahn. They captured the high ground dominating the Vesle River line and succeeded in making the German line along that river untenable, forcing the German army to withdraw.
As a consequence of this, despite the heavy casualties that they incurred, General Hahn was full of praise for the performance of the 32nd Division, and more remarkably and more importantly, I think, so too was General Monchin, the famous commander of the veteran French 10th Army, who bestowed upon each of the four regiments of the division the Croix de Guerre with palm device, making these the four regiments of the 32nd Division the only Guard regiments to receive that highest level distinction from the French Army.
So profoundly were the French impressed with the aggressive and decisive way the 32nd fought, they named them.
It was here that the 64th Brigade was given the name Les Terribles by the French, but later the same name was given the 32nd Division.
Visited with the French 10th commander, who told me we were to be ready to entrain by the 9th, which gives us 3 days to clean up and get equipped.
By mid-September, the division had moved, headquartered in Joinville on the Marne River. They were being refitted for the coming offensive. Some of the division's units were down to just 40% strength.
The 32nd Division was so heavily attrited in its last operations that it began the Meuse-Argonne offensive in the position of a corps reserve.
We were the first American troops to arrive in this section, and our entrance into the town was greeted by a large crowd of women and children.
Replacements quickly filled the division back to fighting strength. In just 12 days, they were loaded on trucks headed for the Argonne Forest and the Germans' heavily fortified Kriemhilde Stellung. As the 32nd moved into the Argonne, they were stunned by the strong defensive positions left behind by the German forces. A maze of trenches and fully furnished bunkers supported by a dedicated rail system.
Leading from this labyrinth of trenches were several dugouts containing flour, hardtack, and other army provisions.
In early October, the division was spread along a line of trenches dug by the Germans, extending east and west just to the north of CH, less than a mile from the German line to the north. The night of October 2nd, the division came under heavy artillery fire.
The night was a rather lively one, particularly in view of the fact that all the openings of our dugouts are in the direction of the enemy, they having been built to resist fire from the opposite direction. This permitted us to locate more accurately, without getting out of bed, the direction of the fires, although it did not feel quite so comfortable sometimes.
News of the faltering German Axis Army had rumors burning through the Allied lines.
Every day brought such reports as these. Rumors of armistice, Bulgaria lays down, Austria ready to quit, Germany on the eve of surrender. But October 3rd, orders were received by the 127th Infantry to be in readiness at 5:30 p.m. to relieve the 37th Division, Ohio troops.
Captain Schmidt was given charge of his battalion. He directed their movement while continuing to fight with Company C. Meanwhile, General Hahn was fighting a maneuvering war, receiving orders to relieve the 91st Division, with the 3rd Division falling into the 32nd's old positions.
These orders were enough to make the Angels cry by themselves. But to cap the climax, another order came for an offensive movement without stating when. This made the Angels have galloping consumption. I hope Bosch will get it soon.
The next morning, the division began its offensive. For the 127th, confusion ensued. Maps used at the headquarters were drawn on a different scale than those in the field. The headquarters maps had details not on the field maps. Schmidt and his men fell back to safer ground while German artillery pounded their position.
After 1 hour of this shelling, I was the only company commander left standing in the 1st Battalion. Captain Spencer, Company B, was shot through the abdomen, but recovered later. Lieutenant Nelson, Company A, was killed by a shell. And Lieutenant Drawheim, Company D, was seriously wounded.
Captain Schmidt and his men felt their position was so hazardous that he ordered his men on a flanking move toward the city of Genet, taking a position on the ridge east of town. Schmidt reported his position to his headquarters.
I received the following message. You're out of your sector. Move to front so you'll get back into sector. Our objective is the plateau west of Roman. Continue the advance without waiting for 2nd Battalion. Use tanks when possible.
Schmidt moved his company west through a dense forest, passing Michigan troops of the 32nd, and on to a pocket of ground south of Genet, a village surrounded by high ground.
It's surrounded by high hills with many towering peaks, and these hills were alive with German machine gun nests. When we discovered our dangerous position, we hurriedly dug shelter holes on the ridge. But before we gained shelter, many of our troops were killed or wounded.
Schmidt ordered his machine guns to engage the enemy, but every volley brought a furious response from the German guns.
It was impossible for us to advance without being cut to pieces.
Within a few seconds, 5 of Company C's men were killed or wounded. Schmidt sent a runner to headquarters, and his men dug in.
My orderly had dug a hole for me, but when I lay down that night to sleep, a dead soldier lying close beside me was my bedfellow.
General Hahn sensed the weight of the challenge ahead, a frontal assault on the Krimhildestalun, the most fortified position on the Hindenburg Line.
I am inclined to think we are going to have a very hard day, as the division is going up against a very hard proposition, a thoroughly organized position which is reported well-manned. My troops are in good condition and will do all in their power.
A 2-hour artillery barrage was set to fire on the German-held high ground, and Schmidt was ordered forward.
We opened up with show-show rifles, directing the fire with telling effect.
In the village, Schmidt found evidence of the Germans' rapid departure, helmets and other gear strewn about. They also found the grim evidence of the 91st Division's failed attempt to hold the city.
The bodies of about 50 dead American soldiers furnished mute and tragic testimony of the advance and retreat of American troops who had been here before us.
The German fire continued against their positions in the village. Schmidt sent word that machine gun nests northwest of town were continuing their fire. On the 10th of October, the division's forward position tenuous, tested by heavy fire, General Hahn recognized the division was exhausted and disorganized. However, incoming artillery was light, and he believed that his troops would recover with a good night's rest. He worked with his fellow division commanders to coordinate a general attack for the next day, but he could not move forward. Their position remained stagnant, but on the 14th, Hahn planned again to attack.
"Our order is ready for a new attack at 8 tomorrow. Our troops are up against wire and will have a hard job. I have impressed with all my force the fact that the position can be carried. My division is getting tired. It needs rest and reorganization."
The following order of the day was received. "The 32nd Division was sent to this sector to shatter that line. You are shock troops, les terribles, the French call you. Fighting sons of guns, the Americans call you. You're the very flower of our army. You that remain up there on the front have been tried by fire."
Unit lore says that it broke every line that it was tasked to attack, but the one line that mattered the most was the Krumhilla Stellung. And it took the 32nd Division nearly a week to break that one line and another 5 days of operations to mop up afterward as well.
The division, tired and with many suffering from sickness, continued the fight, pushing onward, north to Bois de Bonteville.
"Today I made a request to Corps headquarters to have my division relieved. The division has suffered heavily from wounds, sickness, and exhaustion, and I am of the opinion that it is unable to operate any longer successfully."
That night, the division was relieved.
"We have in these last 20 days gained 8 kilometers, and we never have receded an inch of ground once it was taken."
It paid a tremendous cost for this success, contributing mightily to eventual American and Allied victory in the war, but the cost of some 6,000 casualties for this one battle.
As his forces regrouped, Hahn wrote to his friend in Washington, Major General Enoch Crowder, the Army's judge advocate.
"The American Army has before it the most difficult task of any army in Europe. It is on the neck of the bottle, which, if broken, means disaster to the enemy's armies. In consequence of this, the enemy is accumulating before us his best remaining troops, with orders to hold on at any cost, and he is holding on for dear life."
For the 32nd, their relief moved them to support positions as the reserve for the Corps. They were in remote positions, fields far from the basic necessities.
"All the men and most of the officers of the division are lousy. They have no water available for bathing. There is hardly enough for drinking."
Rain was their most plentiful source of water, and it was provided almost every day. It was then that Sergeant Robert McCoy saw a man stumbling across a field.
"God, I said, he looks familiar to me. I went out to see what it was, and God was my father."
Sergeant McCoy's father, Colonel Robert B. McCoy, was commander of the 128th Infantry. He was on his way to division headquarters to see General Hahn, expecting to be disciplined.
"What for? I was just a sergeant. I couldn't." "Well," he said, "there was an inspector came up there and was starting to go through my outfit, which had just come back from the front, giving them hell because they wasn't shaved and their clothes were torn, their shoes weren't polished, and so forth."
McCoy took offense to the inspector's badgering.
"I told him to get the hell out of the place, or I'd kill him if he should came back."
The inspector reported his behavior to General Pershing, who relayed it to Hahn. Hahn, however, took a conciliatory tone with Colonel McCoy.
"He said, you can have any regiment in this division you want, any time. Keep on doing what you're doing. And you know what I told that officer? You threatened to kill? I told him, for God's sake, don't go back to that outfit."
Hahn understood that failing to gain victory before winter would be disastrous.
"If Ludendorff is convinced that he can never again take the offensive, it is my opinion Germany will quit."
Hahn pointed to the continuous reinforcement of the American army as the way to ensure an Allied victory.
"Consequently, we retain the initiative, and there is but one outcome possible, and that is the final and utter defeat of the German army."
On the 1st of November, the Allies began a new push, driving the German army beyond the Meuse River. At midnight, November 8th, the division returned to the front. On the morning of November 11th, the order was received for the 32nd Division to capture the line of hills overlooking the Krusna River. There was to be a short artillery preparation on known enemy positions before the attack.
No, but our company had orders to go at 11 o'clock, and this lieutenant we had, he was all set, good to go, but one of our sergeants, we told him nothing doing. He said, just, you don't move this company out. Just a little, a few minutes later, I was just decided.
Shortly before the hour of attack, the division was notified that an armistice was reached, set for 11 a.m., and that all troops were to hold their positions.
They were euphoric over the armistice. They knew it was coming. And General Hahn regretted the loss of any life in those waning hours right before the armistice. And he actually wrote in his memoirs something to the effect that you've got these armchair generals back home that thought that peace came too soon, that they don't know what they're talking about, and that he just nearly wept to think about every one of these boys who laid down his life.
The 32nd Division was one of three American divisions to cross the Rhine. This occupation force ensured the November 11th armistice would hold until the final peace treaty was signed. Before they moved out, General Hahn officially created the division's now famous logo in an order dated November 14th, 1918.
The symbol of this division is a red crossed arrow. Symbols will be placed on both sides of the vehicle with the arrow pointing to the front and on the tail with the arrow pointing to the right. It is imperative that every vehicle of this division bear this symbol on or before noon, November 16th, 1918.
George F. Kennan in his historical writings has referred to the First World War as, in his words, the seminal crisis of the modern world, seminal crisis of the 20th century. No World War I, no German defeat. No German defeat, no Hitler. No Hitler, no World War II. No World War I, no Russian near defeat in the war, no Russian Revolution, no Russian Revolution, no communist regime in the Soviet Union, no Cold War. No World War I, no Italian dismay at what they didn't get in the First World War, no Mussolini again, no Second World War. And in essence, the outline of the problems in the Middle East was really laid out by the way World War I played out.
The war now ended, the Red Arrow made their headquarters near Koblenz, Germany. There, they would remain until the following spring, when they boarded ships and headed home. After the Battle of Jawinny, Stearns was nominated for the Distinguished Service Cross and was cited for gallantry in action for his work burying the dead while under fire. Chaplain Stearns was reassigned following the Battle of Jawinny to work in an aid station. After the armistice, he returned to his unit.
This brigade has been designated by the French as Les Terribles. We won this name when we were fighting together with the French in the Soissons sector.
Stearns was also awarded the Iron Cross by the German Army for the care he provided to German prisoners of war. After the war, he returned to his church in Milwaukee and soon after began serving as chaplain for the Veterans Hospital in West Allis.
For the relatives of those who sleep in faraway France, if I can do anything for them, I will. God knows we owe them more than we can ever repay.
Captain Paul Schmidt was reluctant, but was finally convinced to write the story of the men of Company C. After the war, he worked as the superintendent of Sheboygan's Parks and Forestry Department. In 1940, he spoke to the soldiers of Company F, 127th Infantry.
Your flag was the first American flag on German soil in that war. Now your organization is being called to the colors again.
Sergeant Ray Fuller moved to Oshkosh after the war and worked as a carpenter. He attended Red Arrow reunions into his 90s. Lieutenant Scott Carey remained in the National Guard, retiring as a brigadier general. After the war, Colonel Robert B. McCoy was promoted twice, ending his career as a major general and commander of the 32nd Division. Wisconsin's Fort McCoy is named in his honor. Sergeant Robert McCoy continued to serve with the Guard and was called up again for World War II. He retired as a captain. And Major General William Bunker Hahn was named War Plans Division Director after the war. He retired in 1922 and died 2 years later. He is buried at Arlington National Cemetery.
And the 32nd's sacrifices and contributions in World War I and subsequently in World War II, particularly in the Pacific, carry on that tradition. And I as a Wisconsinite, feel proud to know that the 32nd Division is, and now 32nd Brigade, is my division and brigade.
The Red Arrow was reactivated after the war as a National Guard division of Michigan and Wisconsin soldiers. In World War II, they were the first United States division to deploy as an entire unit overseas. They spent 654 days in combat, more than any other unit, fighting their way across the mountains and jungles of the Philippines and New Guinea. After World War II, the Red Arrow reformed entirely within Wisconsin. It was reactivated during the Berlin Crisis, spending a year training and preparing at Fort Lewis, Washington. In 1967, the Red Arrow reorganized as an infantry brigade, remaining the Wisconsin National Guard's largest unit. Since 9/11, they have deployed all of their units multiple times in support of the global war on terrorism. In February 2009, the entire unit, more than 3,200 Red Arrow soldiers, were called to active duty in Iraq. In January 2017, the Red Arrow welcomed the return of the Michigan National Guard soldiers to the fold when the 3rd Battalion, 126th Infantry, became the 3rd Infantry Battalion of the 32nd Infantry Brigade Combat Team. As it enters its second century of service, the Red Arrow continues to deploy in support of the global war on terrorism. These soldiers are a vital part of the National Guard strength, gaining inspiration from the Red Arrow's first soldiers. They are a dynamic fighting force, capable of deploying and fighting alongside their active duty counterparts, and they stand ready to respond to local and national disasters. It is their tradition. It is their heritage. It is their Red Arrow.